Good morning, everybody, and welcome to another Sunday service brought to you by One Voice Christian Church here in Loxton. I was almost going to say in YouTube. No, it's on YouTube. That's where you're watching it, obviously. Don't mind me. Anyway, I really hope that you enjoy these services, and if you do think that somebody else might enjoy them, feel free to share them. Feel free to also write down below, whereabouts are you watching from? This always fascinates us. We know that half of the views are in Australia and we know that the other half are overseas. How amazing is God to be able to get these messages so far around the world? Speaking of around the world, well, not really, but anyway, let's get into some worship. So make sure you turn up the volume, get up out of your chairs if you're able to, and make a joyous noise to the Lord. And I will see you right back after worship to introduce our beautiful communion speaker.
I would be hopeless without your goodness. I would be desperate without your love. Slave to the darkness, if it wasn't for the cross. You have won me with your kindness. Chased me down when I was lost. Where would I be if it wasn't for the cross? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was a prisoner, now I'm not. With your blood you bought my freedom. Hallelujah. For the cross. Oh, I thank you for the cross, Lord. And all my shame was met with mercy. Now your mercy will be my song. Oh, the glory. Oh, the power. My freedom, Jesus. Yeah, I thank you for the cross.
Thank you. Calvary has bought for me, both now and forever.
Did you get your boogie on with those songs? I really hope so. Absolutely love worship. And I also absolutely love communion. Now, if you haven't got what it is that you use to represent the body and the blood of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, please make sure that you push pause and just hop off and go and get it. And also make sure you come back with a pen and paper. This week, communion is brought to you by our beautiful elder, Andrea Roberts. She has got such an amazing teacher's heart that is just, it's phenomenal to see how she can bring communion into a new perspective. There are so many different ways for people to view communion, and I hope that this one speaks to you. So feel free to take some notes and join us at the table for communion with Andrea.
It's a simple. Does anyone else love that? Whose brain gets a bit fried sometimes? So I'm glad that God is into simple. He didn't make things complicated. So I get the privilege as well of sharing around communion. So if you haven't taken communion before, what it is, it's a little we've got a little glass of juice and just a rice cracker that we take that represents Jesus' body and his blood, but it's not actually his body and his blood, just his claim. Okay, so, all right. We're going to read from 1 John 4, verses 9 and 10. Okay. God showed how much he loved us by sending his one and only Son into the world so that we may have eternal life through him. This is real love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice to take away our sin. And you know what? We're going to make it personal. So can we go back to verse 9? I'm going to read it again. I'm going to leave a gap. And I want you to say your name where it says us. You're going to put your name. You ready? We'll do it together. So let's... God showed how much he loved by sending his one and only Son into the world so that may have eternal life through him. Next verse. So I want you to say your name or say me or whatever is working for you. This is real love. Not that I loved God, but that he loved me and sent his Son as a sacrifice to take away my sin. Simple, but profound. Jesus came to take away my sin, your sin. Jesus came to show God's love, not condemnation, not judgment. Jesus came to show God's love for his people. That's why he died for us. And that's what we're remembering this morning. And I forgot to get someone to help hand out communion. Duncan and Heather, would you like to do that for us? So as we reflect this morning, as they're being handed out, I just want us to reflect, what are we thankful for about God's love? God's love for you, what is it that you're thankful for? So if I was to say this sentence, I am thankful for God's love, what would be your response? I'm thankful for God's love that... That he has accepted me. Thank you, Neville. Anyone else got one? I am thankful for God's love because it's unconditional. Amen. Thank you. Anyone got one? I am thankful for God's love for the family he has given me. Awesome. Amen. I am thankful for God's love
because I need it.
Because I need it. Amen. We can all say amen to that one. That's good. Well, I am thankful for God's love because he forgave us. Is that what you said? Yep. Amen. I think Reg just said that, because he forgave me. Thank you, Lord. So when we get the enemy that comes and tries to whisper in our ear, well, but that thing you did yesterday, that was too big, and you did it again, we can say to him, no, be gone with you. I am thankful for God's love that has forgiven me. We can declare that. We can say, you can say whatever you like in your own words, and say, be still, be quiet, get out, good riddance, whatever words you want to put in there, and say, enough. I'm not listening to that rubbish.
The verse, be still.
Exactly. Be still and know that I'm God. Be still in my presence and declare who he says we are. I am forgiven. I am home. Yes, are we going to mess up tomorrow? 100%. But are we not forgiven for tomorrow still? Yes. Does that mean we go out and sin more?
No.
Because that would be thrown in Jesus' face. But that's something else to be thankful for. Thank you, Lord, that I'm forgiven for tomorrow. That's how much you love me. Thank you, Jesus. Well, let's pray over the animals. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that your body was broken on the cross for us. That your body was whipped and pierced and beaten beyond recognition, Lord. You did that for us. And we thank you, Jesus, as we remember today, your body that was broken for us. That's it. Jesus, we thank you that by your blood that was spilled for us, we are forgiven. Lord, we're forgiven. And we are no longer condemned. We are simply loved by you. We thank you in Jesus' name.
Great message, huh? Amazing. Anyway, as we move on to the final part of our video today, I really hope that you still got room on your piece of paper and plenty of ink in your pen. Today we have got a lovely gentleman from our church. His name is Tony Swanbury, and he's bringing us the sermon today. Make sure you have a giggle along with the rest of us. It was so much fun listening to what he had to say. So, anyway, that's enough of me. I hope you enjoy the service. I really hope to see you here again next week. And please remember to stay blessed and look for God's hand moving wherever you are this week. We'll see you later.
Welcome again. Welcome to the online viewers as well. You know, before I come over, I was thinking, do you expect to get something from the Lord today?
Yes.
From the Holy Spirit? I've been amazed. I realise that any speaker is simply a vessel that God has got to fill. And I know that what I say isn't necessarily what you're going to hear. I am amazed how many times people have come up after a sermon and said, "We got that." And I said, "I didn't say that." So God's got something for you. He's going to speak to you. So just open up your heart and receive what he brings. The subject for the day is rejoice in the joy of your Lord and walk in his calling. And my problem was I had two sermons, I didn't know how to fit, so I fitted them together. And they're not too long, so that's okay. So, welcome again. So the Lord gave me a scripture, one that I would have memorized when I was about 18 years of age. A merry heart doeth good like a medicine. Who's up for some medicine this morning? I'm going to have some medicine. Good medicine, it says. It says in the Passion Bible, a cheerful heart puts a smile on your face, but a broken heart leads to depression. Depression. Not such a happy ending, is it? Or in the NIV, it says, a happy heart makes the face cheerful, but the heartache crashes the spirit. Amen? So I want to offer us today some good, happy, joyful music. Well, medicine, that's what I want to say. I was watching a sermon the other day by Joseph Prince, and he told this story. I thought it was amazing. It's the story of a man called Norman Cousins. He's an American political journalist, author, and professor. I'm not sure whether he was a Christian or not. I have no idea. But at 51, he was diagnosed with severe life-threatening degenerative collagen disease. I don't know if anyone knows what that is, but it's pretty terrible. He was hospitalized in 1964 with severe pain, high fever, and near paralysis of his legs, neck, and back, virtually unable to move his body. He discovered, I guess in his researches, in line with God's word, that 10 minutes of laughter would give him at least 2 hours sleep pain-free. So as he lay flat on his back in the hospital, he got the nurses together and others to bring in materials like, anything that would make him laugh. You know, the Marx Brothers, cartoons, every single comedian he could get hold of. He's now 71, 20 years later, healed, and he wrote a book and declares the value of megadoses of laughter and vitamin C. How encouraging is that? This is God's word actually working in someone's life. What do the professionals say? What do the doctors say? I looked it up on Google. There's quite a lot. Laughter relaxes the whole body. A good hearty laugh can relieve physical tension and stress, leaving your muscles relaxed for up to 45 minutes. Can you believe that? Time to have a good laugh, isn't it? Laughter boosts your immune system, boosts your energy. Laughter triggers the release of endorphins in your body, which make you feel really good. Laughter protects your heart, improves the function of our blood vessels, increasing our blood flow, which helps protect us against heart attack and other. So a merry heart doeth good like a medicine. So I'm going to try to be a comedian for a little bit. Who's up for a bit of a laugh? Please laugh, otherwise I don't know what to do. You know, my teacher told me that I would never amount to much because I procrastinate. I looked at the teacher. You just wait. Anyway. Well, there was a, you know how hard things are with electricity prices. So the government made an announcement. Due to the high cost of electricity, the light at the end of the tunnel will be switched off. I'm not sure I've got any better than this. Okay. The church signboard read this: love your enemies. After all, you made most of them. How true is that? I mean, you're just saying one thing wrong any old time and then... Oh dear. Just because all the Christians, we can forgive one another. Anyway, there was a story of a new minister moved to town with his wife. It was pretty well known that he'd come, but he thought he'd go and visit his neighbour. So he and his wife, they go over to their neighbour and knock on the door. And this little four-year-old girl answers the door. She looks at them, because she's obviously heard about them, and she cried out to Mum, God is here, and he brought his girlfriend. It's getting better. Oh. Just one last one. There's a family sitting at their dinner table. And a little boy says, Mum, can you eat bugs? And Mum says, no, be quiet. We're going to talk about that while we're having a meal. Anyway, they finish the meal and then Mum says to him, now what did you ask, son? Oh, it doesn't matter, Mum. You've already eaten your soup. Oh, never mind. I give up. I'm not going to be a comedian. Oh, dear.
We still love you.
Yeah. Anyway, is it good? Did you feel better?
Yes.
I reckon you just can't. I love to laugh. I try to make my wife laugh and she tells me not to. So that it seems. Okay, that's good. Happy are the people whose God is the Lord. They're filled with joy. You will draw water from the wells of salvation. There are so many scriptures that speak about joy and happiness in the Lord. Well, that's part A of what I want to share with you today, just to lift our spirits a little. I want to now speak about walking in His calling. And if you want to put up that first scripture, please. So recently, Red spoke on this scripture to us and done a really great job. And I got challenged by it. And I thought, Lord, I'll just read it out. And Jabez called on God of Israel, saying, "Oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me and that you would keep me from evil and that I may not cause pain." I don't need that bit. So God granted him what he requested. And I felt to ask God to enlarge my ability to witness to others, to enlarge my territory in this area, because I need it so much. But that's been it. So I'm going to ask God, you do know how dangerous that is, don't you? Because he will test you very quickly. And it wasn't long. I felt there is service in the Bible where it talks about calling, our calling. And Paul's letter to the Galatian church, he wrote this about himself. "When it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me through his grace." He's literally saying, as Jeremiah said the same thing, that he was called from the womb. That's quite interesting. You know, God formed you and me. And it says so in Psalm 139, that he formed you in your mother's womb and that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. Hello, wonderful people. Hello. You're wonderfully made. Is that right?
Yes.
Amen. Let's rejoice in that. And I've come to believe this as I meditate on it, that God has called me and he has called all of us that know him. And he called us from the womb. It was always his intent that we would follow him and be his children. Can we put up the next reading, please? This is speaking, I guess, was spoken to the Christian church at the time, but it's also speaking to us. And man is a lifts us up before God. "But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvellous light." Amen. Who called you out of darkness. And I can recognise in my own life, God called me out of darkness and he brought me into the kingdom of God, into his marvellous light. Amen. You know, interesting in the Bible, it says, "Many are called, few are chosen." And I thought about that. I believe everyone is called, but only those are chosen who choose him. Those who choose him, they are chosen. Amen? Anyway, I knew I was going to get tested. So I put this little scripture in just to encourage myself. This is, can we put up Romans 8, verse 28? "All things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose." All things work for good. Isn't that encouraging?
Yes.
We think sometimes it's not going to work, but all things work for good. So following the Monday night teaching, the Monday night teaching where Red was speaking on the gifts, I was to share at the preparatory shack. And that's where you share a testimony. And on the third time, so I had to find a new way of sharing that. But it was more or less, how have I measured up to his calling? Man, that's a bit shocking when you do that, you see. But I could see God, where he worked. I could see where I failed. He never did, but I did sometimes. But that's good. Well, before the meeting started, there was a man sitting basically in the church, and he had dreadlocks and all the rest of it, and a hat on his knees, and he had a bowl of soup on that, and he was eating his soup. So I went over to him and said hello, and how you going? And he said, "Oh, I don't like talking much. like, you know, too many people. So I said, oh, okay. Well, interesting. That's a bit, pretty good lie, actually. Anyway, when I got up to speak, I'm going to tell you the story. They told me about this guy. He had two men from the Berry Church were trying to help him. And he'd rung one of them and said, I'm going to hang myself. This was about 2 or 3 weeks before. And so these guys went around there and where he was going to do this. And as they drove in the yard, he jumped out of a tree with a rope around his neck. Quick thinking of one of them was an ex-police officer, drove the car underneath him, and they were able to support him, wrecked the top of his car. But they were able to save this man's life. So this is what we're dealing with. So about halfway through my talk, obviously he got challenged, and he reacted. And he came waltzing up the front, and he said, I've got to tell you what happened while I was in the hospital. I said, well, what do I do? Man, oh man, what do you do? 30 men there? Well, I handle this. Obviously, there's a spirit of death on him and half a dozen other spirits that you could recognize. So I thought, oh, and I said, Lord, he said, just let it go. So I did. I said, let him carry on. Well, he cleared an area. And he started running around in circles. Did that 3 or 4 times. Then he went like this. There's the mountain, he said. There's the mountain. And there's smoke coming out the mountain. Then he did a few more rings around and around and around. And again, he did the same thing, basically. Then he started opening doors. Creak. And he run around the circle. Creak. And he run around the circle. Creak. And he run around the circle. Anyway, when he seemed to have finished, he said, would you mind sitting down now? I need to finish. So he sat there. He would ask. Anyway, I've been praying. Lord, is this just a mental reaction or episode? Or is it a dream that needs interpreting? I don't know whether I'm right or wrong in this. Now I've been asking the Lord, and this is what God gave me. Circles. Speak of lostness, confusion, without direction. The mountain, the gap between mankind and God, caused by sin, high and unreachable. Smoke. Do you know there's not much about smoke in the Bible, but I'll tell you where it was, Sodom and Gomorrah. That's where it talks about smoke. That's judgment. And then finally, the creaking doors. Life choices with no answers and no hope. I hope to see him again because I believe God's put on my heart to tell him about Jesus, who came down from heaven to earth, who died for him on the cross. He rejected that message when I talked to him at the meeting afterwards, but I believe he needs to hear this. And I believe, you know, he came to save us. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. You can't get lost if he's that. He's the light of he's the light of the world, the light that lights our way. Oh, that was the first one. Hallelujah. You know, there's a reading in 1 Peter, chapter 5, verse 9. I don't often experience the Holy Spirit just in emphasizing something to such a point I couldn't get it out of my brain. Seriously, and this is what it says. But may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Jesus Christ. The God of all grace. I just couldn't get it out of my mind. The multitude of grace of God, the magnificent grace of God, just... Yeah, I said it really began to dwell in my mind. It made me feel revived. It refreshed me. It energized me to want to share it and look out who I was going to come in contact with, because I just, you know, when the Spirit of God gets hold of you like this, it just gives you a word that you want to speak out. Anyway, I do most of the shopping these days. My wife likes to do the shopping, but I'd get in there and get too quick, so give me a chance. Anyway, I found that there's a retaining wall in Woolworths, which I've claimed as the wall of hope. I'm starting to follow Emma's ideas, you know, let's claim it. And I've had many conversations with people on this wall because they're waiting for someone and they're a captive audience, they can't get away. Anyway, the other day I was walking there and there's a young lady that used to come to this church a lot, and I don't use names because I don't think that's right. Anyway, she looked pretty sad, downcast. And I walked over and I said, "Can I give you a hug?" And she said, "Yes." So I gave her a hug, and then I just sat down beside her, and the grace message just poured out for 20 minutes. I didn't stop. And she was like a sponge, sucking it up, sucking in Jesus and his love and forgiveness. Amazing. You don't see this very often, which I saw more often. Anyway, we parted. I went back in shopping. Then she chased after me and wanted my phone number. I don't know whether she'll ever use it, but gave it to her. Anyway, but with the same woman, 2 weeks later, I came, same day, sitting on the wall, waiting. And as I walked, as I walked toward her, she went like this, embraced me. We didn't have much of a conversation, but I was so encouraged. God is mighty, isn't he? Mighty. Also the other day I was in scarves because I had trouble with my computer, which I would have liked to chopped up with an axe, but I was in there all day. Anyway, maybe God had a plan and purpose in that, because when I walked in there was a man that I'd known, used to be a member of Living Waters. And now I guess Lockscare is his church. Anyway, there was a bit of, there's lots of waiting in that, in Garth's electronics. So he was standing there and I walked up to him and said, to add a bit of a conversation, said, "You know God loves you, don't you?" And this man looked at me and he said, "Yeah, I know God loves me. But that love needs to be shown, not just spoken." Wow, what a... I've got to catch up with that man. You can hear the hurt, can't you? You can hear the hurt in that. And so that was just another opportunity that's about, it's got to happen down the track somewhere. Can we put up Ephesians chapter 2 verse 10, please? "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God has prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Wow. Have you ever really dug into that and seen what that's saying? It's done it. He's already planned it out for us. We don't have to do anything. God's prepared beforehand for those that he wants us to minister to be able to help, encourage, whatever it might be. You know, when I was looking up our creation of man, when God made man, it said there that really that we made us to be visible. God made us to be visible, loving reflections of an ever-loving, invisible God. Isn't that amazing? But that we are to be a living revelation, basically, of who God is. That's why we were created, in his image, in his likeness, and some scriptures say. Well, then I started thinking about this. Well, Noah, Moses, Joseph, King David, Esther, Ruth, Joshua, Gideon, Samson, all the prophets, all called. Guess what? None of them were perfect. Hey? I used to think Joseph was perfect, and then I realised he was a brag artist. He said his old family up, walking around in his pretty coat when they had none. Saying he was they going to bow down and worship him. Can you imagine how you'd feel? He ended up in a hole because of that. So no one's perfect. But God's called us despite that. Amen? And I love the commissioning that Jesus gave. It's found in Matthew chapter 28, I think. And Jesus said, I have all authority. So in other words, he had all authority. No one could come against what he said. This is it. This is the authority from God himself. Go, he said. Make disciples. Tell people about my love. Do that. Baptize. No, baptize me at that baptism you've been talking about. Teach. Okay? And then he says, I am with you. Oh, thank you. To the end of the age. Right to the end. He is with us. He's not going to leave us. Ever, ever, ever. Can we put up our last reading, please? Galatians 6, 9 and 10. And this is really... I feel for you, Rick. Don't grow weary. For all of us, in fact. Don't grow weary. Because it doesn't always work out well. Okay? So let's just read this. And let us not grow weary while doing good. For in due season, this is a promise. We will reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. And there's a lesson in there too. Love one another, especially brothers and sisters in Christ. Amen. So, I'm pretty much finished. But I have a challenge for us all, for me and for you and for whoever's watching. Become who God created you to be. Amen? Come. Become who God created you to be. And do what God created you to do. Do what God created you to be. Laugh a lot. That is good for you. Best medicine. Rejoice in the Lord. He loves you and he called you to follow him. Reflect Jesus to all you meet. One last testimony. I was in Foodland this time. Boy, you watch out on this food when I love going shopping. Anyway, I was in Foodland and a lady called, I will give her name because it's a nice story. Marlene Floyd, who recently was widowed. Her husband died, I don't know, a few months ago. And she started talking about some of the terrible things that are going on, and the difficulties sheep farmers are facing, for example, in Western Australia and everything else. And after we conversed for a while, we sort of parted. And then the Lord said, go back. So I went back and I said, isn't it wonderful we have the Lord Jesus Christ who's given us a sure hope? And her face was lit up. That's all we're going to do.
Yep.
And finally, this is my last thing. This is what God has shown me, and he's saying to you, God will never say no when you ask to pray for strength, wisdom, help to carry out God's given call. Amen. He will never say no. He'll be with you. Amen. Praise the Lord. If you want prayer, if you feel that you want a bit of energizing? I'm going to pray grace on you. You got grace? You will see things happen around you. And the God of all grace, he's with you. Amen?
Amen.
You'll get an early minute to be enjoyed.